Everybody to the third lecture by Professor Ori Christensen, and today is going to talk about duality result in frame theory and open problems, the good part of it. Please.
Thank you very much. So the focus will actually be on open problems. Now I have been terrorizing you for a couple of days with results that have actually been known for most of them for quite a long time, and now I want to show what kind of problems you can actually attack with the knowledge that we have obtained here during the last couple of days. I don't say that the problems are easy. All of them are problems that I like very much myself, and therefore clearly I've been working on them with my colleagues, but we simply didn't manage to do anything with any of them. Before I start with open problems, let us just look at what we did yesterday. So we introduced some operators on L2, and I told you that there are certain commutator relationships. You need to be careful with the way you compose them. And somehow for the Garber system, this problem disappeared yesterday because we were looking at the Garber frame decomposition, where you can see in the second line from below, the inverse frame operator appears. But then I told you that the inverse frame operators actually commute with these operators of modulation and translation. So that means you can move it in so it hit the function g. So that means that the canonical dual actually still has the Garber structure. And you somehow just have to calculate this function s to the minus 1 g. Then yesterday, we actually decided to look at general dual frames, because the argument was that we might not control the properties of the s to the minus 1 acting on g. But at least from the point of view of structure, we are keeping the Garber structure in the dual also. What I want to do now is to speak a little bit about the corresponding problem for wavelet system, because this is motivating the first one of the open problems. So for a wavelet system, this is, like we saw yesterday, this is what we see in the last line of the slide. For the wavelet system, you do the same. You look at the canonical frame decomposition, and then you get the coefficients given as inner product between f, and then you take the wavelet system, but you act with the inverse frame operator. And then the beginning of the day is okay, because it turns out that the inverse frame operator actually commute with the scaling. But then you get stuck at that point, because the inverse frame operator does not commute with translation. And if you think about using this in practice, this is really a big problem. I mean, one problem is that you simply might lose the wavelet structure, because you cannot take the s to the minus one and move to the other side of the translation. But I would say an even bigger problem is in terms of calculating these coefficients, because you actually have to look at the translates of the function psi, translates by kb, and then you have to act with this operator s to the minus one on all these functions. It's not enough that you act on one function, like in the Garber case. You have to act with s to the minus one on an infinite collection of functions, and this is really a heavy duty. So I would say that this is not very convenient what's going on here. There are nice results by Bonig and Weber, where they looked at a wavelet system where you bump into exactly the problem that we're discussing here, namely that the canonical dual does not have the wavelet structure, simply because the operators do not commute. But on the other hand, there exist infinitely many functions such that the corresponding wavelet system actually form a frame, and such that it's a dual of the given wavelet frame. So this somehow motivates that instead of looking at the wavelet frame and its canonical dual, you again do what we discussed yesterday for Garber systems. You try to find other dual wavelet frames. And there's actually a characterization, and this is quite similar to what we did for Garber systems yesterday. I didn't give you the proof. And also here, I'll not give you the proof, and I will not even go into details with what the conditions say. But just by looking at it, you can see that this is something that is very similar to what we had for the Garber frame. And again, you can use this theorem to find a lot of pairs of dual frames. I didn't give any reference to the people who proved it. And this is mainly because there are so many people who have been involved in this. So there are old papers by Chewy, there are papers by Bornick, there are papers by, I think the version that is stated here is from Labatt, Hernandez, and Gulevice. So there are so many different versions of this. And I can also tell you that there's a reason that it is very similar to the version that we looked at for Garber systems yesterday, because I told you that there's a kind of system that contain Garber systems and wavelet systems at the same time, namely these so-called generalized shift invariant systems, and you can actually derive a duality condition for these systems. And then by looking at this, it's somehow obvious that the Garbock case and the Wavell case, they're just special cases of this characterization. It's something you can find in the literature. It's not something that I will discuss in this lecture. I just tell you that these generalized shift invariant systems actually exist. What we'll do now is take this as the starting point for an open problem. And I'll do that by first telling you something that is known in the literature. And I call it a folklore result because it's something that has been proved again and again in the literature. And what it says is, if you start with any Bessel sequence, of course, the Bessel sequence might not have any reconstruction property. It might not even be complete. But what you can do is you can always find a collection of vectors that you can add to the given Bessel sequence, and then you obtain a tight frame. So you can always extend your Bessel sequence to a family that has this nice property of being a tight frame. Unfortunately, the general procedure for doing this is not necessarily something you want to do in practice, because that would imply that you could easily construct tight frames starting with almost everything. So it is actually a quite involved procedure if you want to do it in practice, but to do it theoretically, it's not hard to prove that. But then again, you might ask yourself, how is this working in terms of applications? How is it working if you apply it to, for example, Garbock systems or Wavell systems? And then there's a nice result that is very easy to localize. This is done by Wenxiang Sun, and I guess that Li was one of his students at that time. So they consider any Bessel sequence in L2, which has Garbock structure. And then we assume that the product of the translation and modulation parameters are smaller than or is smaller than or equal to one. You know, this was the condition that we could get a frame. And then what the theorem says is that they actually exist not just any other system of vectors that you can add to the vectors to get a frame, but there actually exists another Garbock system such that you get a union of two Garbock systems and they form a tight frame. So you can always add a Garbock system to the given Garbock system and then you get a tight frame. And you might ask for properties of these systems. So for example, if you start with a function G1 that has compact support, this is probably because you are doing some applications where it's convenient to have compact support. Then you might ask, is it also possible to add this Garbock system again generated by a compactly supported function? And that turns out to be possible, but there's a condition here. So it says that if the first function has compact support and the support is small enough measured in terms of the modulation parameter, then we can also choose G2 to have compact support. And I think it's a little bit an inconvenient restriction that you need this condition on the support of G1. So I looked at, again, like we discussed yesterday, I tried to look at what kind of flexibility we get from the dual frame pairs. And then together with my colleagues in Korea, all Koreans apparently have the name Kim, then we proved that if you start with, we went back to first the setting of general Hilbert spaces, and then we proved that if you take arbitrary Bessel sequences in the Hilbert space, so let's say we take a sequence fk and a sequence dk, then to each of these sequences, we can add another sequence. So for the fk, we add a sequence pj, and to the sequence gk, we add a sequence qk, such that these corresponding extended pairs actually form a pair of dual frames. And I would like to show you how this is proved, because this is the key to the open problem that we want to discuss. But remember that we are doing this because we want to come back to the Garbock question that I just mentioned, namely this annoying issue with the support. So what we do here is to look at the synthesis operators for Fi and Gi. So remember, they are the operators going from L2 into the Hilbert space, and they take coefficient Ci and map onto the infinite linear combinations of respectively Fi and Gi. So you can see it in line 6. There are these operators that we call T and U. Now, in the best possible case, these two systems, Fk and Gk, already form dual frames. That means in that case, you don't need to add anything. And that case corresponds exactly to what you can see stated with blue, that corresponds to the case where F is equal to U T star F. That was what we saw. That was characterizing the duality condition, that the composition of these two synthesis operators with a star on one of them actually gave the identity. And this is then equal to the second term you can see highlighted with blue, namely the classical frame decomposition using dual pairs, namely the sum of inner products F, Fi, Gi. So this is what we get in case they are already duals, but the issue here is they're just Bessel sequences, so that would be too optimistic to expect that. And then we do this classical trick of adding things and removing things. And this is what you can see in the first equality sign in line 7, that then we say f might not be equal to u t star f, but for sure it is equal to u t star f. And then we simply add the f again and we subtract u t star f again. And then this term, identity minus u t star acting on f, that term we expand. You could think about expanding it in an orthonormal basis, but what I do in this proof, and you will see later why, we simply expand it in terms of any pair of dual frames. That means we take a pair of dual frames, AJ, BJ, and then we expand this vector I mean minus U T star F in this pair of dual frames. And then we get the second term you see right after the last blue term. And then if you take this operator I minus U T star, and then you put it to the other side as the adjoint operator, then you see that you actually get exactly a decomposition that look like a dual frame decomposition, because you are having a sum of inner product of F with a collection of vectors, and this collection of inner product you multiply with some elements. And you see all these coefficients you're looking at, they are exactly the sequence of elements Fi. And then in the second inner product, they are the elements I minus U T star, the adjoint of that, acting on the elements AJ. So these elements will form the first pair of the frame, and the second pair will be formed by GI put together with all these vectors BJ. So you can see that the structure of these elements that you have to add together to the GI, they are given from the proof because they are simply equal to this BJ. This family BJ that is the second pair of the dual frames that we choose. And the first pair, you also see it in the proof. You don't see that explicitly because this is the family Fi we are starting with, but then you're adding the vectors that are given by the operator I minus U T star adjoint acting on the vectors AJ. So the one pair is given quite explicitly, but the other one is given in terms of this operator I minus U T star. Now, we want to return to the Garber case, and it turns out that this theorem actually is very nice from the point of view of the Garber frame, because also what I proved with Kim and Kim is that if you start with any two Garber systems, where you assume only that the product of the parameters AB is smaller than or equal to one, then you can add two Garber systems such that the corresponding pairs consisting of two Garber systems actually form dual frames. And we avoid the problem with the support, because what the theorem says is that if you start with two Garber systems generated by function with compact support, then also these new systems generated by G2 and H2 can be chosen with generators of compact support. So again, you see the flexibility of frames. When you go to higher level of the frame theory, we simply get more flexibility and we get more properties than we had before. And the proof is actually easy, because what happened is, we look at the proof where we were saying that we have to select these AJ and BJ to be a pair of dual frames. So let's go back and look at it. You see it in line 7 that we take this pair of dual frames AJ and BJ. And then in the last displayed equation, the third line from below, you see that then the system of vectors BJ that we are putting together with the GI, they are born to have the Garber structure, if we choose the AJ and BJ to have Garber structure. So the issue is only the collection of vectors that we are adding to Fi. And this is this collection I minus U T star adjoint acting on AJ. And now remember, we have chosen AJ to have Garber structure. So that means the only term we need to look at is this I minus U T star adjoint acting on AJ. But AJ was the Garber system, so we put it in. This is EMB TNA acting on this T1. But then again, we can use these commutative relationships. I didn't really demonstrate for you how they work, but if you simply make the calculation, you see everything is given explicitly here. T and U, they are just the synthesis operators. You can write down how they look like. You know how the modulation look like, how the translation look like. You can make this calculation, and then you can see that these operators actually commute with I minus T U star. That means what comes out of this is a Garber system. Then you might like to do the same for the wavelet system. And then we do exactly the same thing again. So exactly like we did here for the Garber system in the third line, we look at the operator I minus U T star adjoint, but now we act on it with a wavelet system. And if you do that, you bump into exactly the problem that we saw at the beginning, namely that this operator T U star does not commute with the translation in the wavelet system. That means you are getting from the general theorem that you can extend your system to a tight frame, but you don't get that you are extending it with a system having wavelet structure. And this, of course, leads to an open problem, because then you can formulate it like I do here in the last three lines. You can say, starting with any pair of wavelet Bessel sequences, can we extend it to a pair of dual frames by adding one more wavelet system to each of them? So we start with these wavelet system and then ask, can we add one more wavelet system such that these two extended pairs actually form dual frames? And I don't know the answer to this question. It is somehow related to a conjecture by De Guenhain, formulated in 2009. So he was not thinking about the dual pairs of frames, he was thinking about the tight frames. So he had a conjecture saying that if you take any wavelet system, then we can actually add another wavelet system such that we obtain a tight frame. We cannot keep maybe the bound, the Bessel bound of the wavelet system we start with, but what it actually means, this idea with the constant that should be sufficiently large, what it means is that you might start with a wavelet system that has a Bessel bound equal to one. And what he's saying is that if you take a constant that is sufficiently much bigger than one, so he does not really specify what he means about that, but for a sufficiently large value that is larger than one, then you can obtain a tight frame by adding one more wavelet system to the system that we are looking at. And there's something interesting about this conjecture, because with Kim and Kim, I actually obtained a partial result. And this partial result says that if we look at the two given Bessel sequences, and we assume that the Fourier transform of one of them, one of the generators, is contained in the interval from minus one to one, then we can actually extend it to a pair of dual frames. So if the Fourier transform of one of the generators has sufficiently small support, then we can actually do the extension. So the only problem is, what happens if the support of the Fourier transform is too big? And the interesting thing about the conjecture of De Guenhain is that he's conjecturing it like this, but it is motivated by an example. And if you check this example, it is actually an example where the support is contained in the interval from minus one to one. So that means we were looking at the problem from two different angles, but somehow it's the same thing that is going on, except that he extends to tight frames and we are aiming at extending to dual pairs of frames. What are you doing in mathematics if you are hitting a problem you cannot solve? You're trying to relax the conditions. So we are hitting the problem that we don't know if we can extend a wavelet system, a pair of wavelet systems, by adding one more system. So therefore, if you want to relax that, you could ask, but what if we allow to add two systems, such that we have a combination of three wavelet systems on each side? But actually, this makes the question trivial, because then when you start with a given pair of wavelet systems, then you can use the first system you add simply to cancel the action of the wavelet system that you have, simply by putting a minus on one of these generators, psi one or psi two. And then this is canceled. And that means, after having these two wavelet systems, when you look at the decomposition, if you want, that comes out, this is simply equal to the zero function. And then the third wavelet system you can add, you can simply take any pair of dual frames and put in. So that means if you relax it by asking for more than adding one wavelet system, then you actually end up with something that is trivial. So this is not interesting anymore. But the open problem is, like I was stating here, giving a pair of wavelet Bessel sequences, and now we know they should be supported not on the Fourier side, not on the interval from minus one to one, can we then extend them to a pair of dual frames? So we have to invent a completely different proof techniques. We cannot use anything that is going on in this presentation. And I must say, I have no idea about how to do it, but I think it is an interesting problem. The rest of the problems I'll discuss are actually connected to a specific topic, namely called dynamical sampling. And there was a talk by Akramel Ruby on Tuesday where he was discussing this. So I will repeat some of the facts from classical dynamical sampling, but my focus will be on the open problems that appear here. And this has really been one of my own focus areas for the last 5-6 years. So I'm very much interested in the open problems that are coming up here. And I must also say I have been hitting them hard, not just by myself, but also with my co-authors. And we have no answers to the questions that are coming up here. So Akram gave a detailed presentation. What I'll do here is to motivate everything based on Garber systems, which did not appear in his discussion. So I'll just remind you about properties that we have for Garber systems. They will come up as examples throughout the talk. So remember that Garber systems, we typically look at either B-splines or the Gaussian as the generators. We know, as we already discussed today, we know that the product of these parameters A and B must be smaller than or equal to 1. And we know that if it is already a frame, then the product is 1, if and only if the system is actually a basis. And another thing that I actually did not say explicitly as we were discussing Garber frames is that they are automatically linearly independent. So that means if you take any generator that is not equal to 0 and you look at any finite set from a Garber system, then it is automatically linearly independent. On the other hand, if you look at the entire system, then it is actually redundant when A, B is smaller than 1, and it has what we call infinite excess. Infinite excess means that you can take infinitely many of the elements in your frame, and you can simply remove them. And then the system that is left is actually still a Garber frame. So this is a very particular property that they are linearly independent, but still you have a lot of redundancy in the system such that you can kick out as many elements as you want. I mean, 10 to the 16th element you can kick out, and then what is left is actually still a frame. This is a very, very striking property of these systems. And this is one of the properties that will play a key role in the discussion. So the work on dynamical sampling was actually introduced by Akram and his collaborators. So Carlos Cabrelli, Ursula Molter, and Sui Tang were the people, and also Ilya Kristal were the people who were on the very first papers on dynamical sampling. And Akram Aldubi has been working with exactly the same people in many other papers, and also work with a whole lot of other people. And they are also people who have been contributing without being part of that particular group. So in Akram's talk, he was motivating dynamical sampling. So I'll look at it from a little bit different angle, because I'll just look at it purely functional analysis without any view on applications. So what we'll do here is just to say, let's consider any Hilbert space, and let's consider a class of operators on this Hilbert space. And then we consider what is called the iterated system. What you can see in the last displayed equation, this simply means that we recursively act on the element phi with the operator t. So the first vector is simply the vector phi, the next one is t acting on phi, the next one is t to the power 2 phi, and so on. This is actually what is called the orbit of the operator t. The questions that we'll ask is then, can such a system be a basis if we choose this class of operators A in a specific way, and if we make a clever choice of the vector phi? And another question we'll ask is, can it be a frame if you choose the operator in a clever way and the phi in a clever way? So the flow of the talk here is that I will actually give a sample of the results in the literature. And then I will characterize the frames that actually have a presentation. You can see it in line 4. It should have a presentation as some iterated system for a certain choice of the operator T. And it turns out that this question is actually quite easy by itself. But there's a bullet more you can see. And this is the one where I say characterization of the case where T can be chosen to be bounded. So it turns out that to get the presentation in terms of an operator is actually easy, but to get it in terms of a bounded operator is very, very complicated. And this is, of course, motivating that we want to look at other ways of representing the frame. And this is where all these open problems come up. And what we will do is actually to follow an approach that I did with my former PhD student, Marcy Hassan Asab. So we somehow turned the question of Akram and his collaborators the other way around, because for them, they were taking the operator as the starting point. They were looking at a certain operator and then ask, what kind of frame properties can we get? And we are doing exactly the other thing. We are saying, what happens if we are starting with a given frame and then we ask for a representation in terms of an operator? And then after solving that question, we say, but if this is possible, when can we do it with a bounded operator? So let's start with the literature. And the first result was mentioned already by Akram on Tuesday. So what he says is that if you take an operator and you assume that it's normal, then you can just forget about the basis property. It will simply not happen. You cannot construct a basis of this type. This is, of course, disappointing. And then the next question is, can you at least construct a frame? But then the next answer is also disappointing. It says if you assume more, namely you assume that T is unitary, then it is also impossible to be a frame. And what Marcy has sent us up and Rashidi, we actually proved that also if T is a compact operator, then there's no hope for the frame property. So what you can see here is that there are a whole lot of negative results in the literature. And I just stated a sample of negative results. There are many more negative results in the literature. The question is, are there any positive results, or are we speaking about the empty set? And Akram already gave you an example on Tuesday. Marcy and I decided to call it the Carlson frame. I hope this is okay with Akram and Carlos and Ursula and the other people who contributed. We thought it was a natural name, because the key condition here is actually the so-called Carlson condition, which you can see in the sixth line. Akram discussed it, so I'll not go into too much detail with this construction, but what it is telling us is that if you are looking at a diagonal operator, this is what you can see in line three, because the operator is acting on an orthonorm basis by just returning the orthonorm basis times a certain constant lambda k. So this means expressing the operator in terms of this orthonorm basis simply gives you a diagonal matrix with lambda one, lambda two, and so on in the diagonal. So if you look at this kind of operator, and you have basically the Carlson condition with certain numbers of lambda j, then by taking a very clever choice of phi, which you can see in the second last line, then you can actually obtain a frame. And this looks very abstract, but you can actually write it down very concretely for specific choices of the lambda k. So what you see in the last line is that you can take lambda k to be 1 minus alpha to the minus k for some alpha that is greater than 1. It is an absolutely wonderful and spectacular construction. So I like it very, very much. The problem is that there are not that many other constructions than this one. And this is what we come back to here. So here it is solved for diagonal operators. But a big meta question here is, what happens if you're looking at classes of non-diagonal operators? What kind of conditions should the operator satisfy? And how should we choose phi such that we actually can get a frame as this iterated system? And there exist theoretical results telling us that such frames actually exist, and there are many of them, but this is different from really getting hands on them. And the issue here is, how can we get hands on such constructions? This is a big question. So I call it the meta question, because this is really the big overall question for me in this array. How can we identify other nice constructions? Now let's look at the approach that I did together with Marcy Hassan Asab. And as I told you, we first want to find out, when is it possible to look at a frame and then make a representation in terms of just a linear operator? And that turns out actually to be very, very cheap, because what is stated in the proposition here is that two statements are equivalent, namely the first one saying that such an operator representation actually exists. This is simply linear. This is equivalent to the given family being linearly independent. And of course, we are thinking about this from the point of view of applications. So what are the linearly independent systems that we could look at? And this is the very good news here, because I already told you today that the Garber systems are automatically linearly independent. So the proposition that we are doing here, we can apply it on Garber systems, and then we are getting that any Garber system can actually be represented as an iterated system using a linear operator. There's another system that is somehow a little bit more fundamental than the Garber systems, and this is what you see in the first line of the example. They are the so-called shift invariant systems. And they are the systems where you simply just fix a function and then you translate it. So in the Garber system, you translate it and you modulate it. But in the shift invariant system, you simply just translate it. And since the Garber system is linearly independent, then of course, such systems, they are just sub-sequences of Garber systems. They are, of course, also linearly independent. And they play an important role also in harmonic analysis. You can just think about Shannon sampling theorem, for example. Then you'll see a case where they are coming in, a classical example. So they are linearly dependent, both of them. What about the wavelet systems? And this is actually a funny story, because if the frame is tight, then it was proved that by Martin Bornig and Darren Spiegel, that such systems are actually linearly independent. So that means you can also apply the proposition to such frames. But what happened to frames that are not tight? Are they also automatically linearly dependent? And I don't claim that you can found a new Microsoft or anything like that by solving this question. But I really think that it's a gap in the literature that we don't know if the same is the case for arbitrary wavelet frames. So I would like to have an answer to that question also, but I must be honest and say I have no idea. I don't even have a conjecture. Or maybe I have a conjecture. I would actually think that they are linearly independent, but I don't have anything that could look like a proof of that fact. Now, the proposition has told us that the representation in terms of a linear operator is actually cheap, because this is just linearly independent. What about the boundedness? So for the boundedness, we actually go back and look at the synthesis operator one more time. So if we are just considering any Bessel sequence, or for our purpose, we actually look at a frame, then we remember that the synthesis operator is the one in line two, the one that takes a sequence of coefficients in L2 and map onto the infinite linear combinations. The kernel is a topic that you know from general harmonic analysis or general functional analysis. This is simply the set of inputs that returns zero. So this is the set of coefficients in L2 such that the infinite linear combination is equal to zero. And what does it mean that the kernel, for example, just consists of the zero vector? This is something we characterized in the first lecture. This means exactly that the family is a Riesz basis. But we need the kernel for general frames. And then we will look at the so-called right shift operator on L2, which simply put in a sequence in L2, and then it shifted by one element, and then it put in a zero on the first spot. They're the ingredients in the boundedness theorem that I'll state now. So this is part of the PhD thesis by Hassan Asab that is stated here. And what it says is that the following conditions are equivalent, namely the one that we are interested at, that the frame has a representation in terms of a bounded operator. This is equivalent to, and what we know already, now it should have a representation, and it's in terms of a bounded operator. So in particular, because it has a representation, it must be because the family is linearly independent. But the question is, what is the second condition that we need to add to get such a representation in terms of a bounded operator? And this is what Marcy Hassan-Assab found out in her PhD thesis. She proved it herself, actually. And she proved that the condition is that the kernel of the synthesis operator has to be invariant under the right shift operator. And I think it's an absolutely wonderful result, because it is characterizing the presentation in terms of a bounded operator in terms of something completely different. So what has this boundedness to do with invariance of the kernel under the right shift operator? This is something when I think about it, I cannot really give a nice explanation why this is the case, but the proof shows that the statement is true, and it's just a wonderful intuition to make such a statement, combining things that seems to be completely different. Of course, the real test, whether it is useful, is can you apply it to something in practice? But we come back to this point in a few minutes. It turns out to be equivalent to something else that is also closely related to what we spoke about. So you are starting with the frame FK, and then we consider any dual frame DK, and then the condition of being representable by a bounded operator turns out to be equivalent to the number of equations that you see here. Namely that every time you take an integer j, then the element f j plus one should be equal to an infinite linear combination with coefficients in a product between fj and gk times the element f k plus one. So this looked very operative. It looked like something you can check. Maybe it's mainly something you can use to disprove the representability in terms of a bounded operator, because if you want to prove that your frame can be represented using a bounded operator, you'd have to verify all these equations, but it's an infinite number of equations. And that could be difficult to do in practice. So it's somehow easier that you check the equation for j equals 1, and maybe that holds, but then you check the equation for j equals 2, and suddenly you bump into an equation that is not satisfied anymore. And then you can say, okay, then the conclusion is that we cannot represent our operator with a bounded. Represent our frame with a bounded operator. So I think it's in most cases it's probably easier to use it to disprove the representability. Independently of these statements, if you can represent your frame using a bounded operator, the same statement actually tells you how you can choose it. And the choice is very similar to what you see in the bullet number 3. I'll not go into details with it, but you can see how the operator T has to look like. Now the question is it just something that look nice on paper, or is it something that you can actually apply in practice? And I think it is a very useful theorem, because let's look at some cases. Remember that so far, the only case we know of a frame that can be represented using a bounded operator, that was the Carlson frame. And we are aiming at finding some more cases. Let's start with the simplest thing that we could look at all, namely a Riesz basis. If you look at a Riesz basis, then this is actually something that satisfies the condition number 2, because a Riesz basis is a basis, so it is clearly linearly independent, and the kernel for the synthesis operator, this is what we just discussed, this is just the zero vector, and the zero vector is clearly invariant under any linear operator, in particular under the rightshift operator. So that means the condition 2 is satisfied, and this is telling us that a Riesz basis actually can be represented as an iterated system. If you look at condition 3, we could stop here, but you can also look at condition 3, and then you can use the fact that we also discussed on Tuesday, namely that the dual frame of a Riesz basis form a biorthogonal system. That means these inner product fj, gk, they are equal to 0, all of them, except when j is equal to k. And that means for j equal to k, then you're getting exactly fk plus 1 on one side and fk plus 1 on the other side. And that means this condition is also satisfied. So in this case, you can actually verify the condition, because all of the other equations simply die out. So the conclusion here is that we have this corollary saying that any Riesz basis has this form. And of course, in 2016, as Marcy and I found this result, we got very optimistic, because we were saying now we have a concrete case where we can make this construction work. And we were thinking that this would open the door for a whole lot of other constructions. So one day we came to the office and then we say, let's start with a Riesz basis. And then we simply add one element. So this means that we are looking at a frame that has XS equal to 1. So we have the Riesz basis and we just add one element. And our intuition was completely clear. We were saying, yes, of course, such a system can also be represented using a bounded operator. But sometimes mathematicians are just wrong. And it turns out that if you're adding one element, you completely destroy the property. If you're adding a finite number of vectors to a basis, you are completely destroying the property. And this is what you're seeing in the corollary, the last line here. It says, if you look at a frame and we are assuming that it's linearly independent, so it has a representation in terms of a operator. But then if it has strictly positive and finite excess, that means if it consists of a basis plus a finite collection of vectors, then this operator would always be unbounded. There's nothing you can do about it. And that was really a hard hit for us, because we were saying, what can we do then? We were thinking that it was so easy to get other cases. But mathematicians, they don't give up that easily. So we were saying, but then look at the Gauer frames, for example. They have infinite excess, as we have been speaking about. So how is it for frames with infinite excess? Can we prove something for such frames? And then it's too much to look at all frames with infinite excess. So we know for sure that there are some frames with infinite excess where it works well, namely the Carlson frames. They are hugely redundant. So we know that there are cases of frames with infinite excess where the frame can actually be represented in terms of a bounded operator. But what happens if you look at, for example, the Gauer frames? That would be another class. So the question that we formulate here, we look again at all these standard frames, shift invariant systems, Garber frames, waveless systems, and then you ask, can they be represented via a bounded operator? The answer is no for all of them. And you ask yourself, why is the answer no? The reason is, I actually gave a talk about this at a conference in 2017 at Estonia. And then we discussed with Friedrich Philips, and he came to us after the talk, and he said he could actually solve this question. So I was formulating it as an open problem, and he said he could solve that. And what he actually proved was that if you take an overcomplete frame and it has a representation with a bounded operator, then t to the power n of f will actually tend to zero as n tend to infinity. Exactly like you saw, I didn't show you the calculation, but if you look at the Carlson frame, you can easily see that the norm of the elements in that frame actually go to zero. It requires a calculation, but you can show that they will go to zero. And this turns out to be the case for all of these. And all these systems that we mentioned here, shift invariant systems, Garber frames, waveless systems, they consist of vectors with the same norm. Think about the shift invariant system. This is just consists of one function, and then you're shifting it. But shifting it does not change the norm. And the same is the case for Garber systems and waveless, because these operators that we're acting with, they are unitary. So all of them fall in the category of equal norm frames. And that means t to the power n if cannot go to zero. So that means this is simply at one spot kicking out all these frames that we want to look at in harmonic analysis. And this is, of course, a sad news. Now, again, mathematicians don't give up that easily. So if we look at the Garber systems, we could look at any of the other systems. We could look at the Wayland systems or the shift invariant system. But just to illustrate it, I will look at the Garber versions here. So what we know already, they are linearly independent, and therefore they have a representation in terms of a linear operator. What we know now is the only problem is the operator cannot be bounded. It's the boundedness that is the problem. Then a question that I consider somehow natural is, can we somehow pull out the, I mean, when an operator is unbounded, it's because it explodes at some point. But can we somehow pull out coefficients from the operator such that we end up with a bounded operator? And this is the question that you see here in the last three lines. Can we find a representation of the Garber systems or any of the other systems that we wanted to look at under form t to the power n of g, but where we have pulled out these some coefficients an, and what we gain from this is that the operator t becomes bounded. We have been looking at this many times, but for this one, I would say I actually don't have a conjecture here. I don't want to say either yes or no. I think it's interesting. So if you can do it, it would say that this two parameter family, for example, the Garber system can be put into just an orbit, but an orbit of an operator where we have to scale each of the terms by some coefficients an. So somehow it seems likely that it can be done, but technically we have not been able to do anything here. And another question that you can also ask here is, you can start to play around with the index set. So here we always go from n equal to zero to infinity, but what if we start with n from minus infinity up to infinity? That means we are also including t to the minus one, t to the minus two, and so on. So this of course requires that the operator that we are looking at is also an invertible operator. And that would be the second question. Can we take a Garber frame again with a, b smaller than one, and then find an operator representation in terms of what we call a bi-orbit system? I mean, iterated system starting from minus infinity to infinity. And if you look at the Garber system, but try to put your hand on the operators, EMB, try to take EMB out, then the Garber system is TNAG. So then it's just a shift invariant system. And a shift invariant system actually has the form of t to the power n phi, where n is going from minus infinity to infinity, because you simply take the shift and the shift by whatever one or b or whatever you call it, and then you repeat it, and then you get the shift by two and by three and by minus one and minus two and so on, and this corresponds exactly to the displayed system with the index set going from minus infinity to infinity. So somehow I would think that it would be natural that this can be done, but there are some partial results by Rosario Corso, and all of them are actually negative. So it's definitely not something that we can do in general. So maybe also the intuition is wrong at that time, at this point. Maybe somebody can prove that this is not possible, but at least it's an open problem as it is stated here. What are you doing if you cannot make it work with one iterated system? Then you try to put together more systems. And this is what we did again in 2016. So we consider a frame with the additional property that it's norm bounded below. So that means that could, for example, be any of these Garber systems or shift invariant systems, because all of them have the same norm. Then what the theorem says that came out of our analysis is there's a finite collection of vectors that we call phi 1 up to phi j, and corresponding bounded operators, such that the frame can actually be split into a finite union of these iterated systems. So that one we can apply on the Garber systems and the wavelet systems and whatever you would like to do. So we can always do it with a finite collection of vectors. What we don't know, and I will skip the remark, what we don't know is there's this number j that appear in the construction. How many iterated systems do we need to represent a given frame? How is this related to the redundancy of the frame? How is this related to the excess of the frame? So we don't know anything about this. We just know that such a number j exists, but we have no hand on it. And of course, in practice, you'd like the number j to be as small as possible, so you have as few iterated systems to deal with as possible. But there's no information in the literature about that. So the conclusion that we have so far is actually that it's a very weak condition to represent a frame using an iterated system. What is really a hard condition is to do it in terms of a bounded operator. And I already mentioned that the entire iterated system, this is actually what we call the orbit, but there's also another topic that is called a suborbit. I don't know if this is standard in the literature, at least Marcy and I call it the suborbit. And what this means is that you are representing your family in terms of an iterated system, but you don't use all iterates. You can see it in the second last line. So that means you might act with the operator t to the 5, and next time you act with operator t to the 15 and t to the 20 and so on. You only select some of these powers. And then you ask for representability in terms of such a system. And there's an absolutely wonderful construction in the literature, and it was a long time before people started to worry about at least dynamical sampling did not exist at that time. Frames existed at that time, but nobody thought about them in this context. And what it says is that you look at any linearly independent system, and here I put frame in brackets because it does not even need to be a frame, it just needs to be a linearly independent system. And then what the result says is that then there exists a bounded operator and an increasing sequence of powers such that the given system can actually be represented as this suborbit that comes out, t to the power alpha k acting on the first elements. So it has nothing to do with the frame property, but at least we can apply it on the frames. This theorem can be applied directly on Garber frames, for example. So Garber frames can be represented as an iterated system via a bounded operator, but just not using all the powers, just using selected powers. So this is the very nice thing about the construction, that we can apply to all these frames where we had problems so far. The negative thing is that the proof is extremely complicated in practice. And this means that if you're starting with even an orthonormal basis and you want to make this construction, then you end up in huge mess if you just add a single element to the orthonormal basis. So the construction in the procedure is something that is very complicated, and it's not something you want to do in practice. It actually involves choosing a dense set of points in the Hilbert space and then work with that one. And this is definitely not something you are doing in practice. So the question that I would like to formulate here is, can we find a more feasible procedure to do this? And we don't know, and it seems to be an extremely complicated question. So these people, Halbering, Kitaj, and Rosenthal, they were very, very clever. And when they come up with such a clever proof, it's probably because it's more or less necessary. But it's a nice question, and it would be wonderful to have an answer to that. I'll stop in just a very short time. I just tell you that somehow Marcy and I, we got very disappointed by this, all these obstacles. And therefore, we started to look at iterated representations of a frame, but approximate representations. And there are a lot of advantages of doing this. You can make many more nice constructions at the price of making small approximations, but you can control these approximations. So if you, for example, speak about machine precision, then you can make the mistake as small as you want. So you can go below machine precision. And therefore, from the point of view of practical applications, they are exactly as good as the exact representations. So this somehow ends my presentation, but I would like to end with a slide that is actually only related to my very first talk. And there's a reason that I want to say this at the end. One of my very first questions, the first questions that I wanted to look at as a researcher was that, you know, that we are looking at frames as somehow a basis where you have some redundancy. That means intuitively you can think about a frame as a basis where you have just added a collection of vectors. And the question is this true in the technical sense? And it is very good as intuition, but it's actually not true in the technical sense. So I proved an example here back in the 90s. And this is an example of a frame. And what you can see is I somehow split out elements in an orthonorm base. We start with an orthonorm basis, and then we take the first element E1, but instead of taking E2, I split it out in two vectors with coefficient in front. I take the vector E3 and I split it out in three and so on throughout the system. So this system can clearly not have the property that a subfamily would be a Riesz basis, because the only candidate would be E1. And then you take one of the terms with E2, one of the terms with E3, and so on. This system goes to zero in norm, and therefore it cannot be a Riesz basis. But it is actually a Schauder basis. So it's an example of a frame that does not contain a Riesz basis, but it actually contains a basis. So my question was, will a frame always contain a basis? And what I did together with Pete Casassa was to show that there actually exist very complicated frames where no subfamily is a basis. And this is a very counterintuitive example. And the reason that I want to state this here is, I know that many of the listeners are PhD students, and I want you to have a very open approach to science and always think about sharing your problems with other people. So for me, what happened at this time, I was just at the beginning of my career at that time. And I gave this lecture about this problem, and I mentioned the open problem. And Pete Casassa happened to be in the audience at that time. And then he came to me afterwards and he said, I think I can solve that problem. And then we started to work together and actually solve the problem. And for me, it gave a huge boost of my career that I started to work with such a famous guy as Pete Casassa. And for Casassa also, it actually changed his career completely, because he was a world famous expert in Banach space theory at that time. So he was working with the approximation problem and all these abstract things in Banach spaces. But then because of this issue, he got interested in frame theory. And then after a couple of years, he actually completely switched his field and left Banach space theory completely. And he's now one of the absolutely most famous people within frame theory. So for both of us, it actually had a big impact on our career. And if you go back and look at all these names that I have mentioned through my lectures, most of them are actually contacts that I got because I gave presentation where I spoke about open problems. So I think for you, it's a very good idea to think about it like this, try to share your problems, and it will usually give good things at the end. So that was my last work for this lecture, and actually for all of them. So thank you very much for listening.
Thank you indeed, Ole. Let's thank Ole for this wonderful series of lectures. Wonderful indeed. And before asking if there is any question, please let me show a book I have here. And it's a book by Ole that, I mean, he humbly didn't advertise for that. So if you are interested in this topic, yes, this is the Bible to read.
It's actually updated in 2016. So there's a double thick book here.
Oh, I have this one. So I have to add to my collection. You see my collection back here. I wasn't aware of that. Thank you. By the same publisher, Eric Hauser? Yes.
And it has the same title. So the name is An Introduction to Frames and Riesz Basis, second edition. And it's actually quite exact the double size of the one that you have. The one you have is from 2001.
Yes, but I will have two copies, which is great indeed. Thank you. Yeah. Unfortunately, we do not have time for questions, but I mean, you can contact Professor Christensen by email if you have any question, and I will have your file.
Sure.
If anybody's interested. Look, sure. let's
thank you very much. Yes, thank you.